y'all. I'm Karen Morgan, and this is the Purple Bike Podcast. Yay, let's talk about 1978. That was the year of the Test Tube Baby, Susan B. Anthony Dollars, and Space Invaders, my favorite video game. In 1978, I was in the eighth grade. We were part of the high school, but we were not freshmen. We were called, are you ready? Sub-freshmen. It actually says that in huge letters on the page of our class photos in our yearbook. Sub-freshmen. In my yearbook photo, I am wearing a denim blouse with a large collar, along with a sweater vest. My hair is kind of post-Dorothy Hamill wedge cut, and I'm still not showing any teeth in my photo because I still have braces in the eighth grade. So I'm still basically a total nerd loser, but now I have a description. I am a sub-freshman. The two big toys of 1978 were Hungry Hungry Hippos and Simon, and both of them are still around today. Both were also made by Milton Bradley, who were actually bought by Hasbro in 1984. Hungry Hungry Hippos is a game of marble-eating hippos.
Hungry Hungry Hippos is the name of the game, and whoever hippo gets the most marbles wins.
Now, the marbles just are plastic white balls now, but I think they used to be real marbles. I'm not sure. I think maybe somebody lost and threw a marble at their sister and caused an eye injury, so now they have to have plastic balls. In Hungry Hungry Hippos, there are four hippos. The first version in 1978 had Lizzie, who was purple, Henry, who was orange, Homer, who was green, and Harry, who was yellow. Now, later on, they replaced Lizzie, the purple one, with a pink one named Happy. In the fall of 2009, they kind of ruined Hungry Hungry Hippos. First of all, they changed the pink one to a blue one, and they ruined the names. Here are the names of the hippos now. Sweetie-potamus, Bottomless-potamus, Veggie-potamus, and Picky-potamus. Come on, how about Henry, Homer, Harry, and Lizzie? Or Henry, Homer, Harry, and Happy. Those were fine. Come on, Hasbro. A parent also told me that the game no longer even fits in the box, and you have to take it apart to make it fit, which breaks all the hippos. So Hasbro, come on, go back to 1978 and do it correctly. The other great game of 78 was Simon.
He's gonna play Simon. Nobody beats Simon.
Simon is the challenge you've been waiting for because it takes coordination of hand and mind just to play the game.
Simon was and still is a little electric game with lights and sounds. It looks like a little disco floor. It's got four different buttons and each button plays a different musical note, and it's very disco. You have to repeat the order of the notes that Simon gives you, which gets harder as the game goes on and gets longer. And when you mess up the order, you lose. And then you throw it across the room and the batteries fall out. Anyway, Simon was released by Milton Bradley in 78. They had a midnight release party for this game at Studio 54. This is the most disco game ever created. And speaking of disco, let's talk about the songs from 1978. Most of the top songs in 78 came from the soundtrack to Saturday Night Fever. There was an awful lot of Bee Gees going on. Now, the movie came out in December of 77, but the song stayed on and on and on, but not as on and on and on as this one. Light Up My Life by Debbie Boone. We could not get rid of it. It stayed forever. Now, we may have been losers as sub-freshmen, but we still listened to Queen instead. There were also quite a few songs from a movie that came out in 78 called Grease. Now, Grease came out in June that year. I was 14 when I first saw it. I actually just watched it again the other night with my kids. It's still a great movie, but it's really weird now when I watch it because I can tell that the cast was in their like mid-20s, early 30s instead of like high school age. But for some reason, when we were 14 and it came out, we didn't even notice. Everyone was old back then. There are some movies that we see that stay with us forever. We know all the lines by heart. We proudly share them with our kids. We can just recite anything in these movies. Now, one of these movies, for me, came out in 1978.
Nothing.
Animal House was rated R, so my friend's older sister had to buy our tickets. She just bought the tickets at the box office and handed them to us, and we just went in the door by ourselves and no one really cared. But I remember that day well because that was the first time I saw Animal House, and I've seen it a bazillion times since then. When they were filming Animal House, they went to lots of different colleges that had the right look of Faber College, and this included my alma mater, the University of Georgia in Athens, Georgia. But sadly, the University of Georgia said no because the script was just too raunchy.
Don't you have any respect for yourself?
This is absolutely gross. That boy is a P.I.G. pig.
See if you can guess what I am now. I'm a zit. Get it?
All right, you bastard. Let's go right here.
Animal House ended up being filmed at the University of Oregon, and the president there was so cool, he even let them use his office as Dean Wormer's office. Animal House was John Belushi's first big film. He worked Monday through Wednesday on the movie, and then he went to New York Thursday to Saturday to do Saturday Night Live. The original cast was supposed to be Dan Aykroyd and Bill Murray and Chevy Chase, but I'm so glad that the cast ended up being what it was, because this movie is a masterpiece.
Sorry.
It was also Kevin Bacon's first movie. He played Chip Diller, the Omega Pledge. And his scene at the end of the movie in the parade is just my mantra as a parent and my mantra in life.
Remain calm. All is well. All is well.
Animal House is one of those movies that I can watch together with my family, and it is never, 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 never not hilarious. I think I probably showed it to my kids at too early an age, to be quite honest, but I think the family memories have been worth it. There were some great TV shows in 1978. The first big one in my house was Dallas. It started in 78 and lasted until 1991. It's still one of the longest running primetime TV shows ever. If you never saw Dallas, it was basically a nighttime soap opera. There were two families that were feuding, the Ewings and the Barnes. And the first season started with Bobby Ewing and Pam Barnes getting married. So that was a scandal. The breakout star of the whole series still is J.R. Ewing, played by Larry Hagman of I Dream of Jeannie. J.R. was the only character in every episode of Dallas. Now, who can forget the whole who shot J.R. thing? Spoiler alert, it was Kristen, J.R.'s sister-in-law. Sorry. Also, hate to spoil this for you, but season 9 was all a dream. Bobby's not dead. He's just been in the shower for a very long time. That year was also the first season for Mork and Mindy, with the amazing Robin Williams in his first major acting role. Mork and Mindy was a spinoff from Happy Days. Robin Williams played Mork from Ork, who was an alien who got sent to Earth by his superior named Orson, because I guess Mork was too funny where he lived on Ork, so they sent him to Earth where he had to observe the humans. Now, Robin Williams was so great in this, and he improvised a lot of his lines, and the improvised stuff that he did was better than the writing staff sometimes. So they started leaving gaps in the script so he could just improvise. What an amazing talent, and Mork and Mindy was just the beginning. Robin Williams is missed. Now, my favorite TV show of 1978 was called WKRP in Cincinnati.
Cincinnati, WKRP.
it was the best. It had a huge cast. It had a bunch of talented writers who created really funny scripts. It only aired for 4 seasons for 90 episodes, but I still think to this day it's one of the best sitcoms ever. The premise was that there was a radio station that hired a new program director, and he was played by Gary Sandy. He came in and changed the format of the radio station from elevator music station that played soothing sounds for senior citizens, and then he changed it to rock and roll and to Top 40. The cast included Gordon Jump, who played the station manager, who was just kind of a goofball. I think his dad owned it. Lonnie Anderson played the very, very smart blonde who was the receptionist. She was the receptionist, but she made more money than anybody at the station. There was a guy that was the ad salesman who was kind of schmarmy, he would wear these plaid suits and he hit on women. His name was Herb Tarlek. He was played by Frank Bonner. There was a shy intern who was actually very pretty, whose name was Bailey Quarters. She was played by Jan Smithers. She later got promoted to the new staff. There was a DJ named Venus Flytrap, played by Tim Reed, who was very great. He had to be on the radio at night because he was actually a federal fugitive because he deserted the army. So they only put him on late at night, but he was very, very funny. Then there was Dr. Johnny Fever, who was played by Howard Hessman. He was like an old rock DJ who had gotten kicked off the air in LA for saying booger on the air. So he had to go to WKRP to restart his career, but he was really great doing the episodes. And then there was my favorite character of all, Les Nessman, the news director, played by Richard Sanders, who is sadly no longer with us. Les Nessman was obsessed with the hog farming industry, which allowed him to sort of be a journalist, but also get some prizes every now and then. They kept giving him the Buckeye News Hawk Award, and he would get the Silver Sow Award. One of the funniest things that Les Nessman had was an imaginary office. So no one had an office with a door. So he took tape and like outlined an office around his desk, and he would make people knock on the invisible door before they could enter his office. Les Nessman is credited to me with one of the funniest scenes in TV sitcom history.
All right, fellow babies, and now it's time to go to our live remote man on the scene at the Pinedale Shopping Mall for the big WKRP turkey giveaway. So, take it away, Les Nessman.
I'm here with hundreds of people who have gathered to witness what has been described as perhaps the greatest turkey event in Thanksgiving Day history. All we know for sure is that in a very few moments there are going to be a lot of happy people out here. And I think I hear something now. The crowd is moving out into the parking area, and, oh yes, I can see it now. It's a helicopter, and it's coming this way. It's flying something behind it. I can't quite make it out. It's a large banner, and it says, Happy Thanksgiving from W. Ladies and gentlemen, what a sight. The copter seems to be circling the parking area now. I guess it's looking for a place to land. No, something just came out of the back of the helicopter. It's a dark object. Perhaps a skydiver plummeting to the earth from only 2,000 feet into the air. Second to the third. There's no parachutes yet.
I can't tell just yet what they are, but...
Oh, my God, they're talking! Oh, Johnny, can you get this? Oh, they're crashing to the earth right in front of our eyes! One just went through the windshield of a parked car! Johnny, this is terrible. The
car is running around pushing each other? Oh, my goodness! Oh, the humanity! Oh, people are running about. The turkeys are hitting the ground like sacks of wet cement. I don't know how much longer the crowd is running.
1978 was a pretty good year. We were shadow dancing with Barry Gibbs, we were having Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and we were reading Garfield comic strips for the first time. But mostly we were sub-freshmen, awkward eighth graders, not quite high schoolers, not quite there yet, but soon, very soon, we would be redeemed.
Buddy, you're a boy, make a big noise, playing in the street, gonna be a big man someday, you got mud on your face. Your big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place, singing, we will rock you. We will.
Join me next time when we talk about 1979, when the first snowboard is invented and the Sony Walkman takes over the world and a little group called the Sugar Hill Gang has something called Rapper's Delight. Have a great day, everybody. Thanks for listening.